Respected Dharma masters, respected practitioners and guests. In the last talk, we learned that when we want to reform ourselves, we need to have the three hearts of shame, fear, and courageous determination. To have a shameful heart is self-awakening. To have a respectful heart is to be conscience-stricken. Only when we have both will we give rise to a courageous, determined heart. Once we have these three hearts, we will immediately begin to correct our faults. There are three methods of practice to help us in correcting our faults. The first is changing through behavior. The second is changing through reasoning. And the third is changing from the heart. In the sutras, we read of celestial endurance being. Who helped him to attain achievement? Kaliraja. Buddha Shakyamuni spoke of this example briefly in the Diamond Sutra and gave further examples and further details in the Great Nirvana Sutra. Kaliraja is a Sanskrit word. Translated into Chinese, it means a tyrant, a self-indulgent ruler who is completely without principles. The celestial being was cultivating in the mountains. For no reason at all, Kaliraja lost his temper and had the celestial being put to death by dismemberment. Endurance celestial being did not show the slightest trace of hatred. Indeed, he perfected the paramita of patience. He did not view any person or matter as evil. Think about it. Try to imagine the level of purity of mind that he had attained. What do we learn from our practice of Buddhism? The importance of attaining purity of mind through patience. People might say that we are simply insensitive if we do not differentiate good from bad. Even with a law of cause and effect laid out in front of us, our hearts are pure without any attachments. It is not that we do not understand what is happening around us. We are clear on everything, but we are without the slightest discriminatory thoughts or attachment. As for celestial endurance being, his mind was pure because he had found the true reality. But because sentient beings do have afflictions, it is necessary to explain to them the principles in a progression of ideas. For ourselves, we understand that the four attachments of self, others, phenomena, and time are not real. Everything is equal without the slightest difference. It is to help others. This is to establish differentiation based on the principle of equality. Therefore, differentiation is non-differentiation when it is to benefit others, when it is not for ourselves. Since sentient beings have not yet found their true nature, we would do well to help them learn to correct their erroneous ways and to cultivate good deeds. When we ourselves have attained this state, there will be no more erroneous ways to be ended, no good deeds to be cultivated. This means our minds are in a state of purity and equality, the one true Dharma realm, the state of non-cultivation, the state of non-attachment. Within these, we still do whatever is needed for cultivation and attachment. In so doing, we are not attached to either extreme of emptiness or existence. If we have achieved this state, but do not put it into practice, then we fall into the extreme of emptiness. If we are attached to the appearance of matters and do not thoroughly understand the logic, do not see into our original nature, then we fall into the extreme of existence. We should neither attach to emptiness nor to existence. As great strength Bodhisattva explained, we are to concentrate the six senses on uninterrupted, pure thoughts. With concentration of the six senses, we do not fall into the extreme of existence. With uninterrupted, pure thoughts, we do not fall into the extreme of emptiness. In so doing, our mind is pure without discriminatory thoughts. Everything is in accordance with the true nature. We chant Amitabha continuously without interruption from dawn to dusk, without attaching to emptiness or existence. This is what we need to learn. From the text. Additionally, we should maintain the mind of stillness when we are slandered. Although the slanderous rumors and talebearing spread like a huge fire burning to the sky, eventually, like a torch, it will burn itself out in space. End quote. This not only tells us what we should do in principle, but in behavior as well. When others insult and slander us, if we remain calm and unaffected, then naturally everything will pass. When others verbally abuse us, we need not answer. When they curse us, we just listen. After a few hours, they will get tired and give up. This is a very effective method for handling the situation. When our teacher, Venerable Master Jing Kong, was a teenager studying in school, he learned this from a classmate. because he told us that at that time he was very much like Mr. Liao Fan. He loved to ridicule people and play tricks on them. However, that classmate became his spiritual guide. He was overbearing towards him, even ridiculed him in public. But the classmate never responded in kind. It continued like this for an entire year. And in the end, he got through to teacher. This person was truly amazing. He simply did not return one blow or one insult. Teacher learned this skill from him and has used it throughout his life. Remaining calm and unaffected can also serve to increase the cultivation of ourselves. As for accumulating good fortune, average people would praise us even more, saying that we were truly good practitioners. If it were not for these people insulting us, then we would not have the opportunity to practice endurance. They have come to help us succeed in our practice. Why would we not accept their help? If someone treats us like this at work, and we can interact with them with a mind of purity, our supervisor will admire us, our co-workers will respect us, and our opportunity for promotion will be greater than ever. This person has brought a great advantage to us. Why would we not want to accept it? When teacher was in school and two students would quarrel, usually the teacher would punish both of them. The students would feel that this was very unfair. They would feel that they were right and had thus been unfairly punished. He said that it was not until much later that he understood. In any argument, any fight, both parties are at fault. Both parties are at the same level. If one is high and the other is low, then the argument would not have taken place. For example, an adult would not fight with a child. It was very logical. Now, when we encounter this kind of situation, we can tell right away the high or low level of the cultivator. Thus, when we encounter these matters, we need to know that these individuals are our benefactors. They have come to give us a gift. We cannot return their kindness with ingratitude. First, they have come to test our level of cultivation. Second, we will accumulate good fortune, for we are about to gain the praise and respect of others. Therefore, these benefactors are not bad people, but are actually good friends whom we do not want to wrongly accuse from the text. If we hear others slandering us, get angry, and try to defend ourselves, it would be just like the spring silkworm, spinning its own cocoon, tying itself in suffering. Therefore, no benefit but rather harm is derived from getting angry. End quote. What this passage teaches is not only important in worldly teachings, but also in Buddhism. There are two essential practices in the six paramitas of bodhisattvas. The first is giving. When we practice giving, we cultivate good fortune, and we cannot live without good fortune. This is even truer for Buddhas. We call these perfectly awakened ones Buddhas with perfect wisdom and good fortune. They are unsurpassed in wisdom and good fortune. Thus, it is logical for us to seek these qualities, as our self-nature was originally complete with them. There are three kinds of giving. From the giving of wealth, we attain wealth. From the giving of teaching, we gain wisdom. And from the gaining of fearlessness, we attain health and long life. This is what all sentient beings seek. The Buddha taught us that by planting good causes, we are assured of harvesting good results. The other paramita is the paramita of patience. This enables us to maintain the good fortune that we have already cultivated. If we only practice giving and gain good fortune, but do not practice patience, we will lose our good fortune. The Diamond Sutra tells us that everything is attained through patience. We have no choice but to cultivate the paramita of patience to safeguard achievements, whether Buddhist or worldly. We often read in the sutras of the fire burning our forest of merits. What is this fire? Anger, hatred. If we lose our temper, we will lose all of our merits as well. Thus, it is extremely difficult to cultivate and keep these merits. If we want to know how much merit we have accumulated, think of the last time we gave way to anger. When we give rise to one angry thought, the fire burns our forest of merits. If Pure Land practitioners were to get angry during their last moments, all would be lost. This explains why the Buddha taught us not to touch the body of the person who is deceased within 8 hours of their passing away. Although the person has breathed their last breath, the spirit has not entirely left the body. If we were to touch them, most likely we would cause the deceased to become angry. If he or she were to become angry at this critical moment, they would lose all their merits. Thus, merits are indeed difficult to cultivate and accumulate, for they can be lost at any moment. However, our good fortune and virtue will remain intact. What is merit? It is the pure mind, concentration, wisdom. Think about it. How can we lose our temper but keep our concentration or our wisdom? We cannot. As for good fortune, it is our wealth and intelligence. When our mind attains constant mindfulness of Buddha Amitabha, one mind undisturbed, we can accumulate merits and virtues. But with just one outburst of our temper, all is lost. No more constant mindfulness of Buddha, no more one mind undisturbed. Therefore, we need to constantly bear in mind that merits are difficult to keep. So we need to maintain a high level of vigilance. In our cultivation on the path to awaken, our enemies will often come to create trouble for us. Why? They have an overwhelming need for revenge. They see that we are about to succeed in our achievement and know that once we have attained achievement, they will no longer have the opportunity for revenge. Thus, they will do all they can to obstruct us, to block us in our progress. And the way they hinder us, the way they obstacle us, is by making us destroy, making us burn our forest of merits. But if we are determined not to have our merits destroyed, then no external force can do so. Sometimes, when we encounter unpleasant circumstances or personal problems, we become unhappy and lose our tempers. Who makes us so unhappy, so angry? Probably all those unfavorable conditions, enemies and people stirring up trouble. This is another example of the speaker had no intention, the listener interpreted it to be so. Perhaps the speaker had no intention to upset us, but we interpreted what was said to be deliberate, feeling uncomfortable and miserable, so we may burst out in anger. We may manage some control and keep it inside, whatever our merit is gone. Why would all of our merit be lost with just a small bit of anger? Because we have lost our purity of mind. Therefore, all the teachings and attainment are based on patience and deep concentration. Not only is concentration the key to our cultivation in transcending the six realms, but the key to worldly teachings as well. To remain unmoved by slander is deep concentration, is wisdom revealed. To get angry due to slander is a manifestation of our karmic obstacles. We can choose whether to have our wisdom revealed or our karmic obstacles manifested. The choice is up to us. Are these encounters good for us? Where practitioners are concerned, yes. It is a good training ground for us to constantly have someone causing trouble for us. For to have things not going as we wish helps our practice. If we do not cultivate under such circumstances, then how could we hope to achieve? Therefore, the presence of adverse conditions and affinities provide just the right opportunity for us to discipline ourselves and to practice the paramita of patience. We cannot be thankful enough for these opportunities, much less complain about them. How can we possibly get angry? This is instead just the right time for us to train ourselves. In the past, the method people used in helping a person to learn discipline was to teach them the practice of the paramita of patience. If they regarded this person as having potential and being trainable, then they would not look upon this person with pleasant expressions. They would purposely pick on them at every opportunity, acting as if they disliked the person. This was to see whether this person was able to be patient, able to endure the harassment. If the person was unable to endure and left, then they were forgotten. If we cannot endure, if we cannot be patient, then we cannot attain achievement. Even if we are exceptional in all other areas, if we do not have the patience to endure, then there is a limit to our achievement. In the valuable teachings of Zen, we read of an old monk who severely mistreated one particular student. He constantly reproached and verbally abused the student every time he saw him. One time, when the student was washing his feet, he purposely took the dirty water and poured it over the student. But the student would not leave. Later, the old monk got really angry, kicked him out, and refused to allow him to even come back. The student had no alternative. Unable to stay near his master, he stayed in a distant hallway in the temple, far away from his master. But when the old monk lectured, he would listen outside the window, not letting the old monk see him. After 1 year had passed, it was time for the old monk to pass on the teachings, to retire and choose a new abbot to take his place. No one knew whom the old monk would choose. The old monk asked those who were present to go outside and bring in the student who was listening outside the window, to bring him in so that he could pass on the teachings and the abbotship to this student. Only then did everybody realize that for all those years, the old monk had been purposely training the student. If we were to give up every time we encounter some small unpleasantness and are unwilling to be patient and to accept the torment, we will not achieve. No matter how outstanding or excellent we are in other areas, we cannot attain achievement. The key to success or failure in all teachings lies in patience and endurance. If we can patiently endure, we will achieve deep concentration. And with deep concentration, we will uncover our true wisdom and not be affected by any external conditions. Sometimes we see new people with excellent qualities at a way place, but after only a short time they leave. The residents will smile, thinking it really does not matter. If people do not have the patience to endure, they cannot achieve. It would not matter whether one person, more or less, who could not achieve, stayed at the way place. Those who are short-sighted would consider the loss of a person to be sad. But in the end, it is not so. A truly talented person is one who has attained deep concentration and wisdom, for only with these will we be able to pass on the teachings of the Buddhas, thus enabling Buddhism to remain in this world. Without deep concentration, we will not attain the wisdom. And first, we have to have the patience and endurance to attain the concentration. If we have the wisdom to recognize a true way place, where we can learn from those who can help us on the path to awakening, then no matter how they mistreated us, we would not leave. If we have not yet obtained the learning, how would we be willing to leave? Only when we had learned everything can we leave. Only by doing so are we truly seeking to learn the teachings. If we cannot endure the slightest disagreeable circumstance, if we just left, then we would have been useless, and it would have been pointless to keep us. The words in this passage from the book are very important, for they are a wonderful way to end slander and disputes. We simply ignore them. Even the worst will fade. Therefore, when people slander us, do not dispute, do not debate. Thus it is said, no benefit, but rather harm is derived from getting angry. At work, a superior will not give an important project or promotion to someone who constantly loses his or her temper. When a supervisor tries to assess the worthwhileness, the trainability of a subordinate, he or she will observe the way that the individual acts with others on a daily basis. to see if this person is worth training, is worth another promotion. When they observe that we are easily angered, then they will know that we are not worth training, because our anger will only cause difficulties. From the book, there are other faults and offenses we can change. If we can understand the reasoning behind the need for reform, we will not repeat any mistakes. End quote. These two sentences are the highest principles underlying our ability to change. Mahayana Buddhists adopt this method as it is faster for us to achieve with it. Others change themselves through actions, which are like the branches and leaves of a tree. It is easy to repeat mistakes using this method because it is to change on the outside, action by action, very difficult. Also, it is very painstaking and time-consuming to gain a good result by this method, for it is more difficult than changing through reasoning. It is much wiser to change through reasoning than through action, for the mind is the root, and everything arises from the mind. From the book, what is meant by changing from the heart? Although we have thousands of different types of faults, they all stem from the heart, from the mind. End quote. Positive and negative karma are created by our minds, as is the entire universe. The Buddha told us in the Flower Adornment Sutra that the nature of the Dharma realms arises from our mind. Nature is the essence. Essence is the mind. How do Mahayana Bodhisattvas enter the hell realms when they go there to help the sentient beings? By understanding the principle that everything arises from our minds. We learn from the Earth Treasure Sutra to break through the doors of hell. This is explained in the Flower Adornment Sutra. What is hell? A creation of our minds. Understanding this, we will learn that there are no gates to hell. We can go and come freely. So we can correct our faults by starting to change from our minds and practicing good deeds. If we practice from our minds, then even a tiny good deed, like freely giving a penny to a beggar, would be of infinite virtue, infinite merit. Why? Because it comes from the great compassion that is brought forth from our true nature. It is boundless broad-mindedness. Because it arises from our mind, The good fortune from it is infinite, for it accords with our true nature. However, if the good deed arises solely from our actions, then it is a small merit, for it did not arise from our true nature. How then do we reform from our mind? Through sincerity. We do so by cultivating from the mind, by wanting to correct all our offenses, practicing good deeds, and refraining from wrongdoings. When we correct from the mind, there is no such thing as should or should not. It is necessary to meet the requirements when reforming ourselves by realizing the principles. When we reform from the mind, it is unconditional, pure, and sincere. In this way, giving rise to even the slightest good thought will connect with our true nature. Knowing that everything arises from our minds, we would do well to start to correct our faults from our minds. From the text. If my heart is still of thoughts, then actions will not arise and faults can be avoided. End quote. This is an unsurpassed principle. Purity of mind can cancel the negative karma accumulated over infinite past eons. How can we attain purity of mind, stillness of thought? Through the unmoved mind, which is deep concentration. In the Buddha name chanting method, this is called one mind undisturbed. Once we attain this state, all of our negative karma will be eradicated. However, when a new wandering thought arises, our negative karma will again materialize. For example, when we are watching TV and turn it off, there is no longer a picture, only a clear screen. When we again turn on the TV, the picture will reappear. The karmic phenomena stored in the mind of sentient beings is the same. When our minds are in deep concentration and calm, none of the karmic phenomena will manifest. When our minds give rise to wandering thoughts, the karmic obstacles will again materialize. Understanding this, we would do well to nurture purity of mind, the state of not giving rise to one single wandering thought. As Master Kuan Yin said, the true mind originally contains nothing, therefore collects no dust. We need to know that karmic obstacles exist in our false mind, not in our true mind. Originally, our true mind was pure. It still is pure. An An example of this is wearing eyeglasses. Originally, our eyes were pure. When our glasses are covered with dust, our vision is blurred. There is nothing wrong with our eyes. The problem is with the glasses. Where are our karmic obstacles? They are the contamination, the dust on the glasses. There is no obstacle within our eyes. When we completely eradicate the contamination, the dust, as well as the glasses, we will have pure vision to see perfectly. This is the same as uncovering our true nature to become Buddhas. If we wear glasses, there is still a barrier. Then we are ordinary people, sentient beings. Once we can rid ourselves of these obstacles, then we are Buddhas. What kind of mind are we now using? The deluded mind, not the true mind. There is no hindrance in the true mind. When we try to see everything with our naked eyes, it is like observing things with glasses of delusion. Seeing the external environment through a layer of delusion. This delusion is the 8 consciousnesses and 51 mind objects, glasses that have been heavily contaminated. We then interact with the external environment through the 8 consciousnesses and 51 mind objects. Therefore, the environment has changed to that of the 6 dusts. If we do not apply these consciousnesses and mind objects to see the external environment, then we do not see the environment of the 6 dusts, but that of the true nature. So we would see the nature of form, listen to the nature of sound, and transfer the 6 dusts or pollutants to the nature of our senses. This will purify our minds, enabling us to be able to see our true natures, to become Buddhas. Now, our biggest problem is that we simply cannot rid ourselves of these glasses, of the 8 consciousnesses, of the 51 mind objects. The goal of Buddhist practice is to teach us to let go of these, to transform consciousness into wisdom. Wisdom is the functioning of our true nature. Consciousness is the functioning of the deluded mind. It is the function of the 8 consciousnesses and 51 mind objects. People who are below the level of Theravada sages will still use these consciousnesses and mind objects. Thus, arhats, Pratyekabuddhas, and Theravada Bodhisattvas have yet to clarify their true nature to become Buddhas. They know how to regret through actions, through understanding the principles. But they do not yet know how to change from the mind, from the heart. Why? They do not yet know where their heart is. As we learned in the Surangama Sutra, Venerable Ananda was very smart, but he did not know where his heart was. In the beginning of the Surangama assembly, Buddha Shakyamuni asked Venerable Ananda where was his heart. Ananda could not answer, for he did not know what or where it was. How can we regret from our heart if we do not even truly know what our true heart is? For Mahayana bodhisattvas in truth teaching, the level of bodhisattva above the first dwelling in perfect teaching, 41 Dharma body bodhisattvas described in the Flower Adornment Sutra that their way of regretting is to feel deep remorse and to reform themselves from the mind. We will better understand this once we study the Flower Adornment Sutra, particularly Sudana's visits to the 53 spiritual guides. How did Sudana practice? These 53 spiritual advisors represent bodhisattvas of perfect teaching from the level of first dwelling to the highest, the level of equal enlightenment. They manifested as men and women, young and old, from all walks of life. The genuine practice of Buddhism is comprised of principle, examples, and practical explanations for us to follow. The 40 facile version of the Flower Adornment Sutra is peerless. Although we might not be able to study the complete sutra, the chapter on universal worthy bodhisattvas, conduct and vow, is very important. We need to know how to apply this most outstanding teaching so that modern people will incorporate it into their daily living. This is an excellent sutra for sincere cultivation and is worthy of being widely propagated. Following this principle, ancient virtuous people have often provided us with the guidance to help us generate the Bodhi mind and to be constantly mindful of Buddha Amitabha, regardless of our circumstances. Is this really reasonable? To single-mindedly chant Amitabha all day and all night to reduce our wandering thoughts into one thought of Amitabha? Is Amitabha good or bad? Neither. It is separate from the duality of good and bad, and this accords with our true nature. Good and bad is duality, and this duality only exists in our conscious mind, not in our true mind. We will naturally attain enlightenment when we have been constantly mindful of Buddha Amitabha for a long time. Among 84,000 methods, this method is unsurpassed. If we cannot attain achievement due to our insufficient efforts, it is all right because we can still see Buddha Amitabha. And once we see him, we will uncover our true nature. This expedient and convenient way cannot be found in other methods. In other methods, if we do not attain enlightenment, we will not be considered as having achieved. It is necessary for us to, it is not necessary for us to be able to witness the true nature when we practice constant mindfulness of Buddha Amitabha. But if we can see Buddha Amitabha, then we are considered as having achieved attainment. How do we cultivate the mind? We do so when we are constantly mindful of Buddha Amitabha. All of our negative karma will be eliminated when we single-mindedly and sincerely chant Amitabha with utmost sincerity. How could Buddha Amitabha have any negative karma? Buddha Amitabha is true and perfect goodness. It is not the goodness of good or bad. That kind of goodness is relative. True goodness is separate from duality. It is the absolute great goodness. From the text, if our heart is rooted in faults such as desire, fame, profit, or anger, we do not have to find ways to get rid of each fault. End quote. This is just to give us some examples. We have millions of faults, but we do not have to find each and every one of them. Those practitioners specializing in abiding by the precepts do so by disciplining their behavior. They think about what went wrong. They think about how many mistakes they committed every day. They carefully think of each and every one and then correct them one by one. Thank you.